has claimed that nearly 4% of the men and 3% of the women in America are homosexual. Now, with the military ban on gays and several marches down the streets of Washington, the homosexual issue has been brought to the forefront of the American media. Homosexuality is most easily defined as someone who has a love, including a physical relationship with someone of the same sex. Now, today on Time 2, we're going to see what God's Word says about this very sensitive issue. I believe that this program will clear up a lot of questions and bring healing to many lives. Our special speaker today is Wayne Andre with special music by Rachel Rachel. It's Time 2 looks at Confused. Somebody would get sick, I would get a chance to fill in. Today is a real special day for me because I feel kind of like I'm 12 years old again. We have an all-girl group here today that's not just an all-girl group, but they love the Lord, they save, they serve the Lord with their music. Would you please welcome for the first time to Time 2, Rachel Rachel.
You are the one I know. So in order to deal with the subject properly, we must separate the person from the sin, just like with the sin of lying, stealing, or adultery. Now, just dealing with the sin of homosexuality, God's word is very specific. Genesis 19 tells us of the moral decay of an entire society through aggressive homosexuality. Judges 19, detailing the incidents of Sodom and Gomorrah, describes homosexuality as wicked, vile, and disgraceful. In Leviticus 18, verse 22, God issues the strongest indictment through the law of Moses when he says this about homosexuality. Reading from the King James Version of the Bible, "Thou shalt not lie." Now, the word lie here means to have sexual relations with. "Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is abomination." Now, the best way to describe the word abomination is this. It means infinite, incessant spiritual nausea, meaning that if God had a stomach, he would vomit at the sight of these practices. Now, as harsh as these things may be to hear, one thing is certain. God's view of homosexuality is crystal clear. If you do not have center stage a heterosexual ethic, your culture, your community, your nation, your civilization will be destroyed.
Through the media, homosexuals have sought a more reputable image. They are attempting to redefine the traditional family, but this is just an ultimate lifestyle.
Wayne. dealing with homosexuality is how somebody gets into it, what type of frame of mind do they have to be in? Does it start when they're babies? Does it start when they're young? I mean, how did you get into a homosexual lifestyle?
Well, really, I knew at a young age that something was wrong, something was different. And
so this started for you when you were very young.
Very young. I always played with dolls and played with my cousins and did racism. I did the whole number. And as I grew up that way, I never had the role model of the father. The father was there as far as physically, but never emotionally. So my mother used to dress me as a little girl, and she'd run off to New Orleans with me. I'd tell everybody, everybody said, look how cute this little girl is. And I think as I went up in my life, people began to identify with me being a sissy. And as I grew up and went into high school, they started calling me George like me. And I was in a Catholic school, and I really didn't know what that really meant, because my father almost spoke to me about sexuality.
I thought Rob and I had a lot of straight friends and all these courses and things they talk about, and then when I was young, and I was confused because I thought, how can I know this thing?
I've been in gay lifestyle for about 8 years, and I guess I can say I was full into it. I wasn't just dabbling into it.
I started at 16 years old, and when I kissed another girl, and those feelings hit me, and at that time, I was going to lock myself in a room for about a week, and so, I'm different. That's why I didn't have any feelings, because God made me to be a lesbian.
Because I was under the covering of my parents, I wanted to be respectful and tried to fight it as best I could.
It really hit me hard because I was so confused. But I thought that's the way he made me, and I had to live that way. That's where the feeling
came. Those who struggle with homosexuality, for some reason, have more difficulty than other people. And this spirit is probably one of the strongest spirits that we ever deal with.
This is what I've been seeking for. You know, this is what I've been seeking for to achieve. And it would let me down. And then I'd be Mormonism.
I thought that because of what I was feeling inside of me, that because it was a feeling that it was natural.
When you're in the middle of the deception, you don't think this is a deception. You think this is unacceptable.
Reality or lies.
This is normal. Until you find out what truth is. And this whole scripture says that the entrance of light.
And someone told me about Jesus, his strengths, his powers, why he is strong. And for the last 6 years, that has been my relationship. And it's not in lieu of AIDS, it's not in lieu of the HIV status. It's the fact that I have obtained a real relationship that no one, but nobody, can just scoop or shake. Because it is an intimate relationship.
And that's what I was seeking all my life. Learning. But to find the reality of life. And I found it. And I
at the end of that 20-year period, something happened that made you think that maybe God had other plans for you, or maybe had a different perspective for your life. What was your turning point that really just changed things around? Maybe not necessarily quickly, but something specifically happened that definitely was a pivotal point.
Well, you know, lifestyle is a very hard thing to be in, and I was doing cocaine to them recently. I was an alcoholic, and the roommate that I was with, he had went to a substance abuse center. He came out. I had three operations on his hand, and I was shooting cocaine up in the air, and I was operating on it that way. And he decided to go to church on Sunday. And that Saturday night, I had decided that I really wanted to do what I wanted. And we were at a bar room, and I went in the bathroom and lifted my hands up to God, and I said, please help me. And at that point, it's like he took the pills off of my eyes, and I saw a creature in the mirror. bearded man, eyes something like a black leather eyes, and he went to the door, the yellow body. And what happened was, the next morning, the roommate didn't even run into the prayer to God, and he did not help me. And he brought me to church, and they called to prayer class, I got saved.
So there was a point where you just reached out to the Lord and said, Lord, I need to hear from you. I need to see you. And God didn't answer that prayer. Because after that point, things begin to alter. God began to reveal himself to you. Okay, so you went to church with your friend. And then
what happened was the kids that was in that class, I was 43 years old at the time, in the college and career class. That was kind of funny anyway. You know, and after we got saved, they brought us up to the pastor. And I was shaking, and I didn't know what was going on in this congregation sitting there. They sat us in the front seat of the church. The pastor shook our hands and said, it's nice for you to be here. And he preached a sermon, and before he started, they put two boxes of peanuts on our lap. And you know, I said to him, and I said, what is this for? He said, I don't know. And when the preacher started preaching, it was called Black God. And it was just like God stood up in front of us and he talked to us all the things in our life. And we used the whole box of tissue. And from that point on, I didn't accept that that was a sin until God changed my mind. The counsel is that
I wonder if I was born this way. Sometimes I imagine myself tripping. I imagine I found the key to myself. She's just so wonderful. I want to have her on here. Because she's full of life and fun and vitality. So God's really blessed you.
He certainly is. And I think it's through your support that with their acceptance. And right now, I can look at a man, you know, I guess totally nude if necessary, and it does not affect me. I can say to myself, thank you, God, for making a beautiful man. But I just do not look at that man, and the whole tape starts spinning out when I have sex with him.
So it's like you overlay those things. The emotional thing is not stimulated. The mental thing is not stimulated. I mean, God has done total great work in your
heart. What we've done is we teach that if you just overlay what Satan's taught you to do with the Word of God and continue to claim that, so it begins to happen in your life.
So when I talk about the mind, we're really talking about the healing. Another important question, and I guess this could be my final question, is, as Christians and as the body of Christ, how can we be most effective in ministering to the homosexual community? Or a friend of ours that's struggling with homosexuality?
I think the basis of the condition is rejection. And I think if you would give someone love and acceptance at the point they are, and not try to change them to not to do this and that, and begin to be a light to them, pray for them. I think that that is in spirit more than it is in flesh. And if we pray for them and lead them in a way that they can feel comfortable, then they will begin to accept you and you accept them, and that gives them a base to work.
Wayne, you have no idea how much your words have been ministry to those that are listening to this program today. Thank you for being here with us sometime too. God bless you.
Thank you. things change than things have been. I want to cry, sometimes I do. There's when love looks true.
There's no way.
That's right. May the good Lord himself slap me silly if I'm still on the field. Came walking out of church, and there they were, standing alongside the road, taking pictures of daisies or something pretty like that.
Well, now what is wrong with that? The good Lord made those flowers so we can look at them.
Well, of course you did. But these two was looking at each other more than they was looking at them flowers. No, they was like the loafers, all right.
You don't know.
They was playing in the bagel, making them fairy eyes at each other. Well, I had half a mind to jump off those church steps and kick those little blue boys and rear them down.
And what did you do?
Well, first I caught my breath so that I wouldn't puke. Then me and the Reverend moseyed on over where they were standing and asked them what in the name of the bar that was they were doing them.
What did they say?
Oh, they gave us some sort of mumbo jumbo about being on the way to some pretty boy architect or something like that. Of course, that got the Reverend all full of the Holy Five. Hadn't been too pretty just talking about that kind of filth on church property.
Well, I can't imagine the Reverend Jenkins getting all ruffled like that.
Well, obviously, you ain't never seen around there with these two boys of us. I thought he was going to hang his clean James Bowler and take a shot at both of them.
Did he?
No. I wish you would have, though. But I guess they started feeling a little uncomfortable. Like, they wasn't welcome. Probably because me and the Reverend just stood there scowling at him like he was the moral majority itself. Now, they got in there for into little sports car and grew up.
So you ran him out of town.
They lucky I didn't play a move your backside.
You are such a piece of work, Gillis, man. I'm sure it's just what our sweet Savior would have done if he came in your shoes.
Well, of course you would have. Just like you done with those folks that were selling pigeons at the church. You kicked them out faster than a 5-second flute.
You are remarkable.
Oh, shucks, it wasn't nothing. Any Christian man would have the sense of a mule would have done the same thing. They just ain't no room for putting up with that kind of folk.
I think you're right.
Well, there you go. I gotta get on over back to the church. Fix some nails and we'll talk to you back there. By the way, you take it easy, all right?
Goodbye.
God's grace is greater than any sin. See you next time on Time 2.